Welcome back to
Software for Science. So, I'm Sean and this is Cheng, and
what we're going to talk about today.
We're going to explain a little bit about how JPEG works and how you can use it in places other than just images. You excited?
Great.
So Sean, we're going to talk about JPEG today. Before we go into what is JPEG, what do you think a world without JPEG would look like?
Probably a lot blurrier, lower resolution,
like,
and slower.
Like lower resolution is even like pixels?
Yeah, probably pretty pixelated. So JPEG, well rather, the advances made in JPEG have allowed us to do a whole lot more with less bandwidth, without having to sacrifice very much on quality, and that shows up everywhere.
That shows up everywhere?
Yeah, so for example, imagine if you had to have a pile of DVDs for every video, you know, or if instead you had to wait another 10 years of advancements in optical technologies before you could actually get a video that worked, you know. All of those things would have had to have been reality if it hadn't been for these advancements in compression technology, specifically lossy compression. So imagine also if your phone only stored a few, you know, dozen or so pictures, because it would probably take just about as much space as the actual roll, you know, back in the older days. So you'd have had to wait even longer in order to get good digital cameras, all kinds of things like that.
So let me pause. What you're trying to say is, if we don't have JPEG, we won't be able to have our YouTube channel.
Well, yeah, okay. So we would have missed out on tremendous fame.
Oh, that's right. So it sounds like the world without JPEG is pretty horrible compared to where we are today. What exactly is JPEG?
So JPEG is a process for reducing the space that images consume, and that has a lot of effects, but it works by using a bunch of psychovisual hacks so that they delete information that you don't see or process anyway, and that you won't remember or notice the difference in.
Psychovisual hacks?
Yeah, so well, I mean, you can just break it down. It's into what you think about what you see. So you may be seeing a lot of information that you just aren't paying attention to. So if you're not paying attention to it, why transfer it? Just delete it.
You said we can delete things or remove things that we don't need or don't really have to see.
Yes.
What do you mean by that in terms of JPEG?
So there's actually a lot of different kinds of information that we're not paying attention to. The first one is in the very first step. We're changing the color space. So typically, sensors are designed in silicon for a red, green, and blue space, because we're matching each one of those three colors. But our visual processing really looks more like intensity and color separately. So that's JPEG will actually decompose this color into brightness and two bands for colors. So that way we can spend more entropy and more space on changes in luminosity or brightness, so that you can actually see those differences and then throw away a lot of information on a color that you probably won't be paying attention to anyway. Your brain, for example, mostly cues on these edges and variations in brightness, but if there's an edge and both segments seem to be a certain color, then if the color happens to fade a little bit over the edge, you won't notice it. And that's just because you're paying mostly attention to the change in brightness, not the change in color. So it won't look any different, even though it actually is different.
So the idea is that now we know, kind of, or some people has figured out how our brain interprets what we see, then you can say, okay, before I focus on the edges, then I can maybe write a computer algorithm to keep most information about the edges and discard others?
Well, yeah, so that's the first idea, that you would think you could just store the edges, and that would get you a cartoon. But instead, you probably want to just pay a little bit more attention to edges and a little bit less attention to color variation. Yes. And so JPEG gives you a way, once you've separated them, that you can just balance your color budget however you'd like.
I like that. I like that term. Balance your color budget. What yeah. is my budget? Is it my storage?
Yeah, it's storage space. So if you only have, say, a few hundred bytes that you want to store this picture in, maybe you you have to trade and lose some of the color, but in or the resolution of color, and instead you can spend more of those hundred bytes locating changes and variations in brightness more accurately. So that's only one of those tricks, though. That changing the balance of or your entropy budget between colors and luminosity. Then you can also choose to delete high frequency information. So for the most part, high frequency information in images is not really the purpose of the image. Instead, it tends to be noise. So noise, by being random, is very difficult to compress, and it wastes a whole lot of your entropy budget or your space. So the way that you would reduce the complexity of the image drastically without actually reducing its quality, and perhaps perceptually increasing the quality, is simply to delete the highest frequency information. Now, the easiest way to do this would be just to wipe out everything in a Fourier transform over a certain limit. That's actually called a high pass. So we wouldn't necessarily want to do that, because you can often get clipping and kind of odd artifacts from that. So instead, quantization, the hallmark of JPEG, has allowed us to smoothly choose how much we want to budget each one of those higher frequency information coefficients, I guess. And so that means that we don't notice, you know, sudden banding or something, or at least not until you turn it really extreme. And instead, you'll get just smoothing over most of that patch.
So you use a word called quantization. If you have not heard about what quantization is, the way I think about it is you have a bunch of numbers and you just throw them into a few buckets that you chose ahead of time. So think about how we store information in computers. Let's say if we have RGB, how many colors? 256.
Each variety? Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe we don't need that many colors. Maybe we just need 16 or something. You're playing a Nintendo or something. Then you can just like
Minecraft.
You can just bucket them in some way. That's a way of quantizing the colors. But yeah. This the quantization we're talking about here is probably a little more nuanced than that.
Not really. So I mean, it's not quite as visible because it changes the frequency spectrum rather than the colors directly. But it's essentially the same idea. You took a continuous space, you sliced it up, and then you only store which bucket it would fall into. Yeah, that's all. So in this case, there's a third part, blocking, that's being applied to this image. It's actually a pretty good idea. So you can imagine that waves, for the most part, aren't going to be propagating all the way across the entire image, right? So you don't typically take a picture of a barcode, you know? So instead, you would rather take a picture where some part has some feature to it and another part has another feature to it. And if you split up this image into small blocks, usually 8x8 pixels, could be 16x16 or something like that, then you allow the computer, or your algorithm rather, to only approximate those waves within those particular blocks. Now this means that if you get a region of 15 or 20 blocks that are, say, sidewalk or sky, then...
Or like my shirt.
Or your shirt, yes. Then you'll pick up meaningful waves in those little blocks, but they won't affect the compression for some other area that doesn't have those waves. So it's a trade-off, because if you knew ahead of time exactly where all of the segments were, then you could just compress each of the segments separately and you'd be perfect. But compressing the whole image is a pretty bad idea, and compressing every pixel individually doesn't compress at all. So picking somewhere in between a uniform 8x8 was a pretty good trade-off.
So we have color space, quantization, and blocks.
Yes.
What are we going to do? I guess we have a high-level overview in this video. What are we going to do in the next?
So we're going to show you how to perform each one of those at home. You can do this in a Python script at about 100 lines, actually. So it's going to be fun.
Let's see what we can do.
Yeah.
See you next time.
Look forward to seeing you next time at Software for Science.
Thanks for watching. If you like this video, please press the subscribe button and we will see you next time.